Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to Facebook Live and our morning devotional, Bible study. And we're going to continue in Philippians chapter 2 this morning. And as you are finding your way to the scriptures and opening up to Philippians chapter 2, I want to just encourage you to be continually in prayer for your brothers and sisters in the Lord as we continue to navigate uncharted waters in trying to do ministry in a COVID-19 culture. And it's our prayer that soon things will come to a place where we're able to have ministry a little more unrestricted. And I don't know that anytime soon we'll be able to shake hands and hug necks, but we'd sure love to have children's ministry. We'd love to go back to having Sunday school and teen ministry and things of this sort. And we're just trusting the Lord that that's going to come in God's time, and that when that time comes, we'll seize that opportunity with a responsibility and safety. And we are in communication with the Christian Law Association, and we've been in touch with a lot of counselors, legislative offices, health officials, and the such like, so that we can make sure that we do things appropriately, and we do want to protect every person that's a part of our church family. That's one of the reasons why we have the drive-in service. That gives people an opportunity still to come to church, but feeling as though they maybe are a little more protected in the respect that they don't have to get out of the car, mix with anybody, they can keep the windows rolled up if they want to. And we're trying to do our best in that respect. I want to say how much I appreciate the faithfulness of God's people to contribute to the ongoing work of the Lord. We continue to do ministry, and it's my hope that even in the coming days, we can begin to take on some projects around the facilities, that while much of the facility is not in use, we can perhaps do some painting, replace some flooring, do some infrastructure updates that have been needing some attention for a long time. And it would be great to be able to do that without having to disrupt regular ministry. And so we'll be talking about that and asking folks to pray about having a part in contributing to that lighthouse offering so that we can keep the light of the gospel shining brightly here at Freeway. And we have several areas that are just in urgent need of some attention, and we hope to be able to undertake some of those projects and be in prayer for us about that. We're in Philippians chapter 2, and we spent all of our time practically in verse number 12 last time we were together yesterday. And so we're going to pick it up back there in verse 12, and we'll read forward from there. And it says, "Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Do all things without murmurings and disputings, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Yea, and if I be offered upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all." Let's pray for a moment. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to study the Word. Thank you, Lord, that even in a global pandemic, we can consistently assemble in this fashion to study your Word and interact, albeit remotely. And God, we're grateful for this opportunity. Lord, be with the many of our church family that are struggling, suffering. God, some have lost loved ones, others are sick, and others are struggling financially due to layoffs. And God, so many problems in our world today, and I pray that you would just stretch forth your hand and touch these dear and precious people. Lord, bind Freeway together through these days where we have been unable to meet together as we would customarily enjoy. And God, I pray that you would help us to see souls saved through these days. And Lord, we're going to trust you for this, and we'll praise you by faith for what you will yet do. For these things we pray in the lovely name of Jesus. Amen. I do want to just simply say that we're still working with all of the various individuals to schedule a memorial service for Pat Chapman. I was up at the mortuary yesterday and trying to get some answers, and things have just been really bogged down with COVID-19. And so please stay tuned. Hopefully today we'll have an answer for you. Of course, this Saturday is the memorial service for Esther Rosenberger, and we'll be keeping you mindful of that throughout the course of the week. In verse 12, yesterday we saw where the Apostle Paul was commending the church at Philippi for the fact that they had always obeyed, not only as when he was present with them, but also when he was absent. They had exaggerated their obedience in the absence of the apostle, realizing that it wasn't a corporate salvation that they had, it was a personal salvation. And they were personally working out the life of a saved individual. And so this isn't some admonition for them to work their way into heaven, but rather to do the work of a saved individual, to work it out. And the analogy that we gave yesterday was that of a couple that gets married. It's one thing to go down an aisle and to say, I do. It's another thing to have a happy home life and to have wedded bliss. That requires a good deal more effort. And so in the same token, God's called us to be his ambassadors, to be his servants, and we do so as bond servants because of love, but there's work required, and there's work required in getting along, being together in harmony and in unity with the people of God. And so we're working it out, and we're doing so mindful that God is watching over us. This passage that says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. It's not that I'm terrified of the Lord. No, it's that I am mindful of the fact that God is with me. He's in me. He's around me. He's watching over me. That's not an ominous thing to scare us, but it's something to keep us mindful of the fact that the Lord is keeping accurate records of those things which we have done for him, and he will recompense those things as well. We know that we're mindful of the presence of the Holy One with us, and that impacts the way we choose to live our lives. And so we understand this. In verse 13, it says, for it is God which worketh in you. Now, it's God that affected our salvation. It's God that has ordained a work for us to do. And it's God that we are to be mindful of as we live the principles of the Christian life, as we work out our salvation with fear and trembling, but understanding that it is God that's working in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. One day, I was reading through this and a light clicked on for me. That happens a lot. And I was immediately minded that this is a great proof text for man having been created as a tripartite being, a man or woman created in the image of God. And when we hear that term, created in the image of God, it means that we are three parts, because God is three parts: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Or it wouldn't be a disservice to say God the Holy Spirit, God the Father, and God the Son. You see, they're one in power, they're one in authority, they're one in rank, they're one in purpose, but they are different in ministry. But they all work together harmoniously to accomplish the goodwill of God, and that for the benefit of His created handiwork, and that's us. And so when we hear the term that we are created in the image of God, it means that we are created in three parts. I was kind of amused lately listening to some liberal politicians trying to say that, you know, these are people created in the image of God, and I know that they were trying to posture themselves as centrists, but theologically, they don't even know what they're saying. And if they did know what they were saying, they were just being deceitful and deceptive because they don't believe it. The fact of the matter is that the Bible teaches us that, yes, we are created in the image of God, because we can go all the way back to the beginning, where that God said, let us, plural, make man in our, plural, own image. And so, what is He talking about? Well, God is a plurality, but one. It's a Trinity. And He created man in His image, spirit, soul, and body. Each part of man relates to one part of the Godhead. And the fact is that each one of those parts that God created is important in the outworking of our Christian faith, working out our salvation with fear and trembling. How does that happen? Well, God gives us the matrix that's based upon how He has ordained us. Now, I just want to say this to you. Every one of us has a duty to understand that we are formed in the image of God. Three parts: spirit, soul, and body, okay? Your family members created in the image of God, spirit, soul, and body. Your children, your spouse, whatever the case may be, created in the image of God. Now, I want to ask you a question. How many good mothers out there? All right, okay, I see that hand. All right, there's hands going up. There's some good mothers out there. Love your kids, yeah, love your kids. And I know that every good mama out there boasts that they prepare their children two square meals every day. Is that what you do? Say, no, Pastor, I don't prepare two square meals. I prepare three square meals: breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I see to it that my kids have all their needs that are cared for nutritionally: breakfast, lunch, and dinner, all three. You know, it's amazing to me how that we kind of adopt the narrative of health, the healthcare experts and nutritionists, and, you know, three square meals a day, and that we care for the total person, we think. But you know what? We often neglect the most important part of a person. You know, listen, a relationship that only deals with soul level and physical level relations is never going to be a fully dimensional, fully fulfilling relationship. The fountainhead of every good thing in our lives is the Spirit. It proceeds from God. And so what I'm saying to you, parents, is this: that if you're educating your child's mind, if you are helping them emotionally, if you are helping them physically, you take them to the doctor, you feed them proper nutrition, you see to it that they get exercise, but you neglect their spirit. God intended them to be fully dimensional individuals, spirit, soul, and body, but you are contributing to a handicapped individual. You're not ministering to who they are. Because listen, man is a spirit that possesses a soul that lives in a body. So who we are fundamentally is a spirit. The Bible tells us that flesh and blood shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So we spend all this time on our physical body, our health, and I'm not saying that we shouldn't. Some people need to spend a little more time with hygiene. I won't name any names. You can figure that out on your own. But nonetheless, we spend all this time on the physical, and we educate our minds, and we have experiences with individuals. We call them soulmates, and our soul consists of our mind, our will, and our emotions. But the spirit is the part that God speaks to. The part of us that we enter into relationship with God by. And it's the part of us that the Spirit of the living God quickens, makes alive when we trust Jesus as Savior. And so a person can read the Bible, but if they don't have a quickened spirit, they're never going to understand it. A person can seek to know God, but until they have a quickened spirit, they will never know him in fullness. They can only know about him academically. So realize that man is a spirit that has a soul that lives in a body. And God wants all of those to work together in perfect synchronicity to carry out the will of God for your life. And so here's how he does it. The Bible says this: it is God which worketh in you. Okay? What is that? Well, that's God speaking to me in my spirit. How do I hear from heaven? In the spirit. So God is working in me. He's creating a spiritual desire, impulse within me by the leadership of the Holy Spirit from the platform of the Word of God. And so he's speaking to me. He's working in me, in my spirit. Okay? And then what happens? Well, I have that impulse from the Lord. My mind begins to think upon what God is telling me. So I begin to think about what the Lord has said, what he's working into me in the spirit. And then, based upon how I process that, then I make choices on the basis of what God has said and the thoughts that I have processed on the basis of what God has told me. So that's me on a soul level making choices. And that's where it says, it is God which worketh in you both to will. Okay, so the spirit part of me, God's working in me to do two things. One, to will. How do I will something or decide something? Well, I think on what God said. I contemplate its truth and what will be involved in that decision, and then I will that. In other words, I make the decision in my soul to respond to the Holy Spirit, and then thirdly, what follows that? To do of his good pleasure. So God says, I want you to be faithful to church. Okay? You read that in Hebrews 10, 24, and 25. And you think on that. You begin to think about what God is saying to you. And God is ministering to you by his Holy Spirit in the Spirit. It's God which is working in you, okay? And both to will. So you're thinking, well, there's COVID, and I'm busy, and, you know, I really like to go to church and see everybody, and, you know, we got masks on, and you're thinking about this, but God is saying, listen, what I want you to do is this. So we try to have the mind of Christ. We try to think in such a way that's compatible with the truth that God has revealed, And then we make a decision on the basis of what God said and what we have thought. And so we will to do that. And then you know what? We get our body out of bed. We groom it, feed it, put it in the car, drive down to the church, and do what God said. God worked in us. We thought on it till we made the right decision. And then when we have made that decision in the mind, the body engages to obey. And so it begins in the happens in your life, springs forth from the fountainhead of the Spirit. I'm going to say something to you that if you're a married individual, you're never going to have a fully dimensional relationship, a fully fulfilled relationship with your spouse, unless you come to the place where you recognize that God made you in His image. And so if truly every good thing springs from the fountainhead of the spiritual, whatever it is that you enjoy doing, perhaps it's even in your perspective a carnal exercise, but if it's something that God speaks to and He commands you to do, He's telling you in the Spirit. We need to contemplate what God is saying do and then follow through on that. When we do it, there'll be a greater degree of exhilaration and fulfillment because it began with God, not just simply by the impulse of the carnal mind, because the carnal mind is enmity with God, the Bible says in Romans chapter 8. So I want to have the mind of Christ. How does that happen? God working in me being in tune to the impulse and the voice of God by His Spirit that liveth in me, and knowing that He is the Spirit of truth as revealed in John 14, 15, 16, and 17, and that He will never lead me to do one single thing that's contrary to the revealed Word of God. And so if I begin to understand that what it means to be made in the image of God is that I'm a three-part being, because God is three parts. The Bible tells us in John chapter 4 that God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. And if I believe that, okay, I'm a spirit. God speaks to me in the Spirit. That's who I am fundamentally. I have a soul, all right, and that's my personality, that's my emotions, that's my mind, my will, and my emotions fundamentally. Or if you would, your thinker, your feeler, and your chooser, okay? And that's what the soul is. And then the bodily part of me, that's the carnal, the fleshly, that's the part that engages to do whatever the mind tells it to do. So look, your husband, your wife, your kids are a spirit. Do you begin with that premise? Do you try to motivate from that premise? Do you try to minister from that premise? Or is it all about your logic and rationale, your emotional posturing, or you're trying to manipulate so that you'll get them to physically do what you want them to do? You know, if they're a saved person, there's a whole lot better result that will ultimately come if you begin with the spiritual premise. If you understand that every good thing in relationships and in our lives proceeds from the fountainhead of the Spirit, your children are a spirit. If they have a quickened spirit, then you need to understand that, and that gives you the perspective with which to know how to help them to grow and to mature and to seek after God and to pursue His will for their life. And so, giving you a little theology lesson right now, and what I'm trying to help you understand is not just a little bit of anthropology and hermeneutology and theology proper, but what I'm trying to help you to understand is that we so often just have a short-sighted view of the people that we live with, and we forget too quickly that they are a spirit. And we fail to really deal with that part of them apart from Sunday morning or prayers at mealtime. And so it's important for us to pray for one another, to express that, to find out what struggles spiritually the other is facing so that you can encourage each other and talk about the things of the Lord. You know, it's distressing sometimes when you're really feeling revived in your spirit, energized spiritually, and it seems like you're living around people that are spiritually out of touch and out of tune. I mean, they can take the services or leave the services. They can take Bible reading or leave it. They can take prayer or leave it. And they're just kind of ambivalent a little bit towards the things of the Lord. And it's distressing to us. And we need to pray. And we need to continually encourage them, knowing that that's who they are. And so we need to keep that clearly in view. And then the Bible says in verse number 14, this ought to be put on a plaque and placed in everyone's home, in their car, on the mirror, in the fridge. Verse 14, do all things without murmuring and disputing. Do all things without murmurings and disputings. Now, how many things are we to do without murmurings and disputings? Let me hear it. All things. You know, I took a little bit of Greek in school and still have a slight level of proficiency with Greek, although I'm not great in it now. If you don't use it, you lose it. And I have a lot of lexical aids that help me. And so consequently, I've come to trust in those to help enlighten my understanding of biblical languages. But the fact of the matter is that I've studied the word all, and I came to this conclusion that all means all, and that's all means. Okay, so you can remember that when you're studying the word of God, all means all, and that's all means. You can't say, well, that's your interpretation. No, all means all, and that's all means. Okay, so look, do all things. What things? Working in the nursery. Do all things. What things? Washing dishes. Do all things. What things? Vacuuming the front room. All right? Do all things. What things? Taking out the trash. Do all things. What things? Doing the laundry. Do all things. What things? Listen, serve the Lord. Do everything that you do without murmuring and disputing. Now, you say, okay, what does that mean? That means, murmuring means grumbling and complaining, okay? Grumbling, I'm just murmuring, I'm complaining, okay? I'm just letting people know how I feel about it. Sometimes if you want to know how God feels about murmuring, just go to Exodus and Numbers, okay, and just read about the wilderness wanderings. Just read about the murmuring of the people of God. Study about a place called Taberah, where the fire of the Lord burnt because of the murmuring of the people of God. Study a little bit about Moses, who was the most humble man on earth, according to God. And yet, despite the fact that he was such a wonderful man, he literally came to the place where he despaired of his own life because of people just grumbling and complaining, murmuring all the time. They just murmured and complained. And we know that as a result of that, there was a group of 70 men of Israel that were called out to help and come alongside Moses. But the reality was, in the end, that didn't work out too well. I think that was the kind of the beginnings of what came to be known as the Sanhedrin that ultimately killed the Messiah. But the reality is this, that look, we've got to come to the place where we got to stop complaining. We got to stop just criticizing. Now, the Bible says do all things without murmuring. That's complaining. and disputing. That's fault finding, okay? That's me always picking at somebody because they're not doing it right. Listen, you know, nobody wants to have someone standing over their shoulder every minute micromanaging their life, do they? No. I was never great at working in an environment where I had a tyrant for a boss that was always looking over my shoulder. I tended to thrive when I was given a task to do, I was given the resources and the time to do it, and I was given the liberty to just go out there and sink or swim. And you know, I think that sometimes what happens is we want to just be the life coach. And you know, the problem is that I've found is this, that everybody that wants to tell you how that you need to do it has areas in their own life, issues in their own life that they need to take care of. You know, the fact is that, yeah, they think they know what you need to do, but, you know, they can't even balance their own checkbook or clean up their own mess. The fact is that they need to take care of that. Before we start issuing advice and complaining about how everybody's doing it, why don't we try doing it? I believe it was Spurgeon had a lady that came up to him and said, Mr. Spurgeon, I don't really care for how you do personal evangelism. I don't think it's the right way of doing it. I don't really particularly care for the way that you do it. And Mr. Spurgeon said, you know, I don't really particularly care for it either. How do you do personal evangelism? And she said, well, I don't. And he said, well, I like the way I'm doing it better than the way you're not doing it. You know, sometimes we could say, well, you know, they should have done VBS this way. Well, you know what? I'm happy to have somebody do it, somebody get involved with it. We had a COVID culture in play, and we weren't living in a perfect world, and we didn't have unlimited resources and time or personnel, either one. So basically, everybody that was involved in it is all under the same roof and family. Not because I'm trying to promote that, but because we're trying to work with what we have. Do you understand? And so we sit by and criticize that, but the Bible says, do all things without murmuring, okay, grumbling and complaining and disputing, criticizing and fault finding. Let me tell you one thing about the Pharisees, can I? The Pharisees added laws on top of laws. They tried to make the tradition of the Pharisees equal to the law of God. And so when someone fulfilled what they thought was the law of God, the Pharisees said, well, you forgot to do this or that. And so nothing they did was ever good enough. It was never good enough. And you know, we know people like that, don't we? It's like you could prepare a meal and man, really pour your heart and soul into that thing and do it as a labor of love for them. Have it hot and on the table when they come in and they're like, man, you know, you should have really put more salt and pepper in this, or, you know, the texture of this is kind of off. And boy, when I make this, put a little more honey in it, or, you know, don't you have any of this type of dressing? And look, they'll find something wrong with it. And it's like you poured your heart and soul into the thing and a simple thank you would have been okay. But all of a sudden, they're on, you know, Chop Chef and picking the meal apart. And it's like, dude, if you don't like it, prepare your own stinking meal. You know, I'm just saying, sometimes we've got to give up on the critical spirit and the attitude, and we need to be content and we need to be grateful for what God allows to come into our life that's better than hell. And decide that I am not going to be a negative, hangdog type of half glass, half empty type of a person that's always nitpicking. But every once in a while, I'm just going to be grateful. Every once in a while, that's not to say we don't teach our kids. That's not to say that we don't admonish people. It's not to say that we don't help and we don't offer advice when it would be timely and wanted. But the fact is that, you know, often the advice that we give is neither asked for nor wanted. You know, and so, look, we've got to come to the place where we understand that, look, this is a part of our testimony. And if you're a negative person that never has anything good to say about anyone or anything, then you need to stop, take a step back and say, I wonder what the world thinks about my attitude. I wonder what God thinks about my attitude. And I wonder what the people that I'm talking to think about my attitude, because that makes a difference. Look, sometimes the opinion that people have of themselves is not shared by everybody in their world. The opinion that, you know, you've got it all put together and we all need to beat a path to your door for some more life coaching lessons because you seem to have it all together and ours is falling apart. People have this idea, you know, I've got it all together, you should be like me. Well, you know what? I just wager that if you took an anonymous poll of all the important people in your life, they may not share that same evaluation. The fact is, we've just got to humbly love people and show gratitude. And you know what? Praise them. You know? It's like, if your kids do their chores, don't come home and complain that they should have done something else. Do you know what I'm saying? Say thank you. Say, man, I appreciate that, guys. Now, sure, we want them to do more because of love. Just, you know, Luke 17, still in the Bible. The unprofitable servant, we get that. But what I'm simply saying is this, that we've got to check our attitudes and understand that God just does not like a critical spirit. And it doesn't serve anybody's purposes. It doesn't help anybody's morale. And you know what? When you pillow your head at night, you don't feel any better for having torn people apart. So how's that working out for you? You know, the fact is that we just need to simply take God at His word, and we need to begin to live out the principles of our Christian faith. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Do all things without murmuring and disputing, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Look, I'm just saying, folks, we need to make sure that what flows from our life comes from the Spirit, not a cankered carnal one, but from the Spirit of the living God. I'm trying to help you today. I hope you know I love you, and I hope that something that's been said has proven to be a help to you. We'll be back here tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. Fellas, we're going to have our men's Bible study on Zoom. I'll be sending you the information today. Be looking out for that. Until we meet again, may the Lord richly bless you.